Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to members of the press to the Governor's latest regular press conference. We have, as usual, 1 hour for the press conference. And again, as usual, Her Excellency will open with some remarks on current issues, and then opportunity for the press, consisting today of James White Jr. from ZJB and Bennett Roach from Montserrat Reporter, to ask questions. Your Excellency.
Thank you. Well, good morning again, everybody. I'm really pleased to welcome you again to this press conference, and it's really good to see you all. It would be nice to see a few more members of the press corps, but we realize that sometimes timing is difficult, as it is for all of us. These last few weeks have been really busy, extremely busy, and fast-moving, I think, for all of us. And I do appreciate and take seriously these opportunities to engage in a discussion with the media on issues of concern. Now, this month in particular, I'm pleased to be able to talk about how some things have been moving ahead in several areas, so I'll touch on these in my opening remarks. First of all, let me talk about the police vessel. I'm delighted to announce that the UK government has agreed to fund a new police vessel capability. While the precise nature of that capability and the timeline for bringing it into service are still being worked out, the business case presented to and agreed by the UK government recommends a large vessel up to 75 feet in length, which can operate offshore and over periods of up to 72 hours, supported by a smaller inshore craft for swift interception operations. Now, this is a substantial upgrade over the MV Shamrock, which will be decommissioned in a timely manner. Procuring a long-term capability of this nature will involve a full tendering exercise to be run by the UK government. It will also require the increase in capability and capacity of the Royal Montserrat Police Service Marine Unit, and the development of suitable onshore facilities to house the marine unit and the vessels. These will have to be developed separately in consultation with DFID and the government of Montserrat. Therefore, in the meantime, the UK government will secure, in shorter time, the lease of a similar capability, which will be crewed and maintained by the company providing the vessels. In addition to providing this service, the successful company will train the current police marine unit. I hope that we will have this short-term option in place early in 2017, if not earlier, and that the long-term permanent capability will follow over the next year or so, depending on the time it takes to ready Montserrat for ownership and management of these enhanced assets. I know this has been the subject of some concern for a long time, long before I got here, in fact, and I'm really thrilled that we have identified a process and a solution that will equip the Royal Montserrat Police Service with a robust, suitable, and dynamic marine capability in both the short and the longer term, as there are still many details to work out, so I can't at this stage provide much more information than that, but I think that's a pretty good place to be with that information. With regard to the prison, I would have liked to have made a statement today about the positive changes being made at the Her Majesty's prison. However, since there are legal matters relating to this, I'm not able to comment, except to say, in accordance with Rule 6 of the prison rules, the superintendent, with the approval of the governor, has established a system of privileges for Her Majesty's prison for the encouragement of the good conduct, industry, and rehabilitation of prisoners. Further, there have been no recent amendments to the existing prison rules. Now, it's a pity that I can't say much more than that today, because there are now some elements of fact that need correcting publicly. And I'm very pleased with the improvements and will speak at more length once the legal matters are dealt with. Okay. Let me speak a little bit about public service transformation, because that's a topic that we have quite often here. In many of the conversations, we've had many conversations around this table about the need for changes in the way that the public service operates, especially related to HR, human resources, which in my mind is the people part, that it's really the heartbeat of the service. So I'm very pleased to announce that Cabinet has established a subcommittee chaired by myself and the Honourable Minister Ryan that will head up an HR transformation program. It will be named Empowering Excellence. Minister Ryan and I have already begun the groundwork to put in place two key mechanisms, a public service task force and a public advisory committee that will ensure input from both the private sector and the public service. We intend to adopt transparent communication on progress through the implementation of this exercise. Minister Ryan and I will make a further and more detailed announcement once these entities are established and have provided their input into how the work will go forward. Now, on the Deputy Governor, I know many of you have been waiting to know the outcome of the recruitment process for a Deputy Governor, which was begun several months ago. I regret to say that the process, and it was an excellent and thorough process, and I want to thank the brilliant and diligent members of the Selection Board, reached a unanimous conclusion that did not result in the selection of any of the assessed candidates for the substantive position of Deputy Governor. So I have decided to appoint a person to act in the medium term in the role of acting Deputy Governor. This is to provide some stability to carry out the role and tasks of the Deputy Governor, which most of you know I have stood in to undertake after the retirement of the previous Deputy Governor, while I look to fill the role on a substantive basis over the next year. An offer has been made, and I will announce the appointment as soon as that process has been completed. So this is a little different than having an acting deputy governor fill in for brief periods of time. We're looking at a medium term so that we're not sort of starting and stopping and so on while we look to fill the position in a substantive way. Finally, I want to touch on the Governor's remarks in the Legislative Assembly coming up next week, or otherwise referred to as the speech from the throne in the sort of technical and formal lore of parliaments and the Legislative Assembly. So you will have heard from the Honourable Speaker of the Legislative Assembly that she has asked me to present the Governor's remarks for the opening of the Legislative Assembly next week. The tradition of a throne speech by the Queen or her representative to enunciate the government's upcoming legislative agenda is a long-held tradition in the Commonwealth constitutional monarchies, which, by the way, includes countries such as Canada and the independent territories of the Caribbean, and others, of course. And it is a practice in most of the Caribbean overseas territories presently. I am aware that this has not been the practice in the past in Montserrat, and I'm very honored that the Honorable Speaker has requested that I perform this governor's duty. Having just attended the ceremonies associated with the opening of the law year this week, also an ancient British tradition much cherished in the overseas territories, I am aware that many Montserratians place great value on carrying out these formal functions that honour the dignity of our institutions of government and justice. It is an honour to officiate at this important function. So this brings to a close my introductory remarks, although Tony has urged me to say something about John Otway and his recording of an album here on the island last week, and all the excitement and so on that brought to the island. So I'll close my own remarks and let Tony say a few things about that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Your Excellency. Just before we go to questions, just on the John Otway project, I was involved in a little bit on the fringes and spent quite a bit of time with the group that came here. And I think the atmosphere that was around last week, both around the team, was one of huge excitement that this was the first time that an international rock artist, and I use that word in terms of rock artist quite liberally, has been to Montserrat to record an album since the Rolling Stones in 1989. So there was excitement about being able to get here to do it, which presented some challenges, but also the excitement that I think is going to be generated when the album and the documentary film that will accompany it are produced and issued in the middle of next year. And some were talking last week about the potential for other recordings to be made in Montserrat, and so harking back to the great days of Air Studios. So I was very excited, and just to plug our Facebook page, there are lots of photographs now on our Facebook page of things that were happening last week, not least the excellent concert, gig, whatever you want to call it, that took place at Soca Cabana last Saturday, which was a great event and enjoyed by many. Thank you.
Your Excellency, good morning again. And I note that you touched on several of the questions that I actually had. And one of the burning ones, I know you mentioned that there are possible legal proceedings. But concerning the prison and the alleged adjustments or amendments to the prison rules, but you clearly pointed out that that's not the case in terms of any adjustment to the rules.
Categorically.
But some of the prisoners, based on the two letters that we have copies of Radio Montserrat and it was confirmed that your office also received copies.
Yes.
Is there any investigation into the fact that there have been some suggestions that these rules have been implemented, some adjusted rules, without going into the legal part?
Of course. When we received the letters, we checked very thoroughly to ensure that the changes that had been agreed were implemented in the correct way. And so, of course, we investigated that. When we receive things like that, we always investigate. So I'll answer that in the affirmative. But to say that the way that we answer those particular letters is in the hands of the Attorney General's office at the moment, lawyer to lawyer, and we'll await that. And after that, I'll be happy to talk at some detail about the changes and the way that they're working and the reasons for them. Yeah.
Your Excellency, Bennett Roach, replying, good morning. I have a difficulty. There's always the excuse being given when issues arise, and where the persons in the hot seat, if you like, take the excuse that we cannot speak to them. You refer to the matter as being legal. It is only a problem, and you can only not speak, as far as I know, when the matter is in court. There is nothing about this matter that's in court. So therefore, to hide behind the fact that it's a legal situation, it's not really fair to the public, because it's only when it's in court that there is an issue that one has to be careful and become mum about. But if we say there are no changes, there are changes, but the changes, some of them were implemented, that's the crux of the matter.
Yes.
That the changes are even unconstitutional.
Well,
and that's the accusation. So
yeah.
Can you speak to that?
I did speak to it. because they would, you know, the issue of the Constitution comes into play if we change the prison rules or if we're going against the rights, human rights, say, under the Constitution, but we're also interested in international human rights. So whatever changes were devised were done with all of that in mind and very, very carefully. But let me just say this about hiding. You know, well, I don't hide, and I'm not hiding now, and I'm not avoiding this discussion, but I am. I want to give the courtesy to the people who wrote to us as well to answer them, you know, formally by letter before I start answering them through the media, and I think that's a courtesy that I deserve when things are raised with me, and it's a courtesy that those who raise them deserve from me.
More on that a little later.
Mm-hmm. Your Excellency, I'm just trying to find out what's the procedure in terms of making those amendments or changes. Isn't it a cabinet decision?
It would be if we were changing the rules, for example. But I will speak at length about how those decisions, suggestions came about, how the decisions were made to implement them, and how they have been implemented, and the details of them, as soon as possible, as soon as we've...
So are you confirming, Your Excellency, that there were suggestions that are now being implemented?
Suggestions?
Asking that you said suggestions...
There were recommendations from a thorough investigation and report by Her Majesty's Prisons Special Advisor, who reports to the FCO. That's his job. Mm-hmm. He's an expert on prisons, and he works for the overseas territories. And there were recommendations made some time ago that we are now implementing a number of them.
So while there are no changes to the prison rules.
Yeah.
There have been certain recommendations that are being implemented or have been implemented. That is what you're saying?
Yes.
So we're a little confused, but we'll take it a little another time.
You will be unconfused when I feel I have the liberty to speak at length about these things.
Yeah, fair enough. Okay. I noticed you began by saying that they were positive changes, positive. I think now we should be calling it recommendations.
There are positive changes based on a number of expert recommendations.
If I guess I'll have to save this for an appropriate place. I was going to say, if I were to make a comment, you see, a positive, but from whose perspective?
Everybody's perspective.
James tells me he'll drop it. Okay, police vessel then. Before we do that, there was something you said about which I thought about the. Oh yes, in your talk about the police vessel. Mm-hmm. You said, in the meantime, something to do about something. I didn't quite get what that was.
So I described the capability, 75-foot, what I've called mothership, and a smaller, what was it, up to 35-foot inshore vessel. Right. I call it the baby ship, but I don't know if that's a technical term. So that's the capability that we're looking at being provided in the short term. But it will not be procured in the sense that it won't be owned yet by us because the procurement process takes some time. So in the meantime, this is a lease. I think we can say that's a leased boat with a crew, with an expert crew. This is something that is provided internationally. So we wanted to... We knew that procuring something this substantial would take some time. It could take a long time. So what we wanted to do was have something in place that would be expertly managed with engineers and so on board, but it will be the police boat, basically. Okay. They will also be on board. In the meantime, they will be trained to use these kinds of vessels, and they will be upgrading the marine unit. Plus, they will be looking to ensure okay. that they have things like berthing spaces and how are they going to do the maintenance in the longer term and so on. Mm-hmm. So it will give us an opportunity to do that planning, but it'll also, at the same time, get us a boat, I was going to say on the ground, but I really mean in the water.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so much on that. You talked about this situation where we're going to be working with the HR situation, and we're going to be having the thing about empowering excellence.
Yeah.
Seems to me that we should be empowering excellence when we have something to empower. What is there that we're going to be empowering?
Could you explain your question a little bit more?
In recent months, there have been so much said. And I have to tell you, I've gotten so many things. People come and make complaints. And that has gotten terrible when I dared to go on Warren Castle show and on two occasions. And people are coming with a lot of complaints that really brought home even more forcefully to me the situation that exists within that section yeah. of things. What I really want to know, though, really, is you talk about you will chair, along with Minister Ryan, a committee. And I've been asking this question for a long time. Who makes up these committees? Who are the people on the committees?
Okay. I'm happy to speak to that. So the reason why I wanted it in particular to be at a level above any department, a level above HR and so on, and run sort of at the center of government, mm-hmm. was because this isn't just about the HR unit or a singular organization or anything like this. This is about really transforming the public service. So that's why it's a cabinet committee. And right now the cabinet committee consists of myself as chair and co-chair, Minister Ryan. When we have a DG, that would obviously the DG would be part of that committee as part of cabinet as well. So that's that committee basically. Then thinking through this, what we wanted to ensure, which I don't think has been done that much in the past, that we also hear from public servants, because there's a lot of public servants who are as frustrated as anyone with the way things are going in the public service, their ability really to be empowered, or their ability to really achieve excellence, among a number of other things. So the Public Service Task Force is going to be a group of representative people from the public service who will work alongside the Cabinet Committee to ensure that the whole process is continuously informed, and they are continuously informed. And then the Private Sector Task Force will be members of the private sector sort of looking in, who will be advising the cabinet committee. So when Minister Ryan and I, probably in a week's time or so, and I may do another mini press conference, because hopefully by then I'll be able to talk about the prison as well, we will have a session where we will answer a lot of questions, because right now we're trying to put those groups together. So we have an idea of who we would like to have on them. They will be representative. But the really, really important thing about this, too, is that this is going to be continuously open and transparent. So there will be communication to public servants about where we're going with this and where we are with this, both through the task force themselves, but through some sort of mechanism like a page, you know. And then also to the public, both through the advisory group, but through sort of public announcements, I think, that we make as we go along. So what areas are we looking at? All of them.
Indeed. Yeah. So I, what I really wanted to hear was that part about the task,
private advisory private committee sector. Or group.
Indeed, that was my, that's really yeah. what I was heading up, yes. going after.
Thanks. Your Excellency, please help me to be unconfused. Please. There are a number of steps that have been taken in the whole reform process, mm-hmm. Public sector reform. And the Public Administration Bill Act?
Yes, it's an act. Yeah.
Act, yeah.
Because it's been signed by
yes.
the, yeah.
There were some legislation, I believe, that you mentioned that you needed help.
Yeah.
To get sorted out.
Yeah.
And now I'm hearing of this empowerment team.
Mm-hmm.
Is it that this team now is tasked with pulling everything together? Because I'm trying to figure out why all these little individual steps, and then I'm getting the feeling that they're not working out.
Yes.
So there's the need now. So yeah. So help explain that to me. Yeah. Help me to understand better, because I'm a little bit confused.
Well, I think you put it very well. You don't sound confused to me at all. It the piecemeal sort of approach to doing this, while it can make some small incremental changes, does not really affect a transformational change. And that's what I'm hearing that people want. So while we may do some of those small incremental things, they will be part of a larger plan. You mentioned the Public Administration Act. You know, I mentioned that act a lot. I like that act. But although it's been signed and so on and so forth, we can't implement it until there are regulations, so I'm told by the lawyers, no matter how hard I push. However, there are aspects we're looking at. What aspects of that, for example, the code of conduct, which is a very good code of conduct, can we implement through other means while the regulations are being drafted? And that applies to a number of other things in the Act. Some of those things can be done, you know, by changing general orders and so on and so forth. Although there is some thought that once we have regulations, we may not require general orders. So that whole thing will also have to be looked at. That's been in the thing for ages. And when you say, you know, it is confusing, I agree. There are so many little things. There are so many little things that don't quite work, and there are several big things that don't work. Remember that I have been doing this DG's work now for 2 months. So I see these things firsthand in a much more detailed and immediate way than a governor usually would. So I have a much deeper understanding of just how these things work or don't work, because I see them every day. And I think that's, you know, that's been difficult for me doing sort of both tasks. But on the other hand, I think it's really equipped me very well to sort of understand the ins and outs and the key things that may be blocking us moving forward, and also some of the small things that could be quite easy to change as long as we were doing it systematically. I don't know if that kind of gets to your issue.
Well, overarching, yes,
mm-hmm.
Because you clearly pointed out that the piecemeal way in which things have been done or are being done, they're not really working out.
Mm-hmm.
But while we're on...
The Public Administration Act, and I was told since we last spoke about it, is not at all enacted. It's not enacted
yet,
is what
I understand. No, because it doesn't have regulations. Yeah.
Because of the regulations?
Yeah, it requires regulations.
But one can have an act and it can function, and then the regulations come after.
That is true with some acts. It depends on the specificity in the act. In this one, because of the nature of it and the complications in it, it requires regulations in order for us to move forward.
Yeah. Now, there are a few things that have been happening which... And a question was tossed at me as well the other day regarding how we handle people who have been charged, suspended as a result from their mm-hmm. positions, mm-hmm. or even who have not been charged
mm-hmm.
but suspended anyway, mm-hmm. as I believe is probably required even under general laws. I don't know. I'm not sure. What's this thing about the half pay business?
That's just a, that's part of the policy, the present policy, basically.
Is it really?
Yeah. Yes, it is. Policy or practice, you know.
Ah, but you see, brings me to the,
No, but it is embedded in the policy. The practice is embedded in the policy. It provides for that. It actually in the I believe it's in general orders, or it might even be in the Public Service Act, which is currently the one we enact. It says that one of the disciplinary measures that can be taken is regards salary. So you can look at that yourself.
I probably can, yes. Once I know where to go and look, I certainly will. You mentioned taking on this whole digital thing. Are you going to take responsibility for keeping away the public from the swearing in of people to Montserrat citizenry?
Oh, okay. I should have actually said in my remarks how pleased I was to be part of that ceremony. It was reported, the remarks I made at that a couple of weeks ago were reported. And
were reported where?
Yeah. Well, I gave the media a copy of my address, right?
Be careful, Your Excellency.
Yeah.
The who?
Who did it go to? It went to ZJB because you asked for it, right? Yeah. But anyway,
I just wanted to catch that phrase.
It was in response.
Media.
It was in response to a request. Anyway, okay. Let me get to the topic at hand, which is just how pleased I was to be able to officiate at that and welcome the people who now have received their British Overseas Territory citizenship. There will be another such event, and there will be more of them because there was a backlog and people are now getting through the system, and it's quite substantial, I have to say. And I'm really, really happy to see, you know, which when I look at these, because I have to approve them, are some of them are quite uncomplicated. But the granting the citizenship ceremony for British citizens or any other citizens is not necessarily a public event. It is a private event. The fact that we have a lot of people all together, you know, so we've had it in a public space, doesn't mean to say that everybody is comfortable with the general public or the media being there while they're receiving their citizenship. So I have to respect that. Media needs to be aware of this, they don't necessarily need to be there. And that's my understanding from the legal advice that we have, that it is not the actual awarding of the citizenship certificate is a private matter. And so if people want to make it public, they can, but some people have indicated that they're not comfortable with that. So that I think we have to respect that. Yeah. It is their right.
Your Excellency.
Yeah.
Rights have responsibilities.
Yes, and what is that responsibility?
That responsibility is that it is certainly my right as well as a citizen to know that ABC has now joined me.
Are you sure that's your right?
I'm absolutely right. It's a right to the public. It's my right to know that. And so it's something that perhaps, see this thing about legal advice? We should always try and check both sides of those advice before we actually take action on them, because
well,
they could
take,
be so well
challenged. I take your
challenged.
Advice on that, and I will revisit it, but that's what I'm advised at this point.
Your Excellency, just note that I'm in this kind of mood. That you mentioned about confused, frustrated, you know, these kinds of things, because I'm really not getting clarity on a number of things. One of the things, I think Bennett touched on it, about this whole issue of disciplining public servants and so on. And you mentioned that there is a provision in the policy to which speaks to salary and halving and so on, as the case may be. But if somebody is not tried and proven guilty, how can you go ahead and take that step to halve that person's salary?
Yeah.
And punishing that person twice.
We don't do that, okay?
Let me just say that
what happens when there is, say, an investigation or an allegation or somebody is arrested, is they are they go on compulsory leave mm-hmm. with full pay.
Okay,
that's what happens, and that's what we do. If they are convicted and they are a public servant, then they move forward into the disciplinary process, which has to determine what disciplinary action will be taken.
Understood.
Yeah, okay, so we need to make a distinction between those things. Yeah, so I have to say that compulsory leave with pay is not a disciplinary action, okay? It is not, with pay, is not a disciplinary action.
Full pay, half pay?
I'm talking about full pay, yeah, is not a disciplinary action. It is not. So when those things happen, there is no, assumption of guilt or innocence or anything. It's just that this is what is done, say, if an investigation is underway and so on and so forth.
That's understood,
yeah,
Your Excellency,
okay.
Because I know before time it used to happen.
Yeah.
Even when the person has not been found guilty or whatever.
Yeah.
Sent on compulsory leave and the salary halved and so on, you know, punishing that person twice.
No,
I'm happy with your explanation.
Okay.
Now, another concern that I have, concerning some of these processes. One, the process, procurement process is one, for instance, and the process to select the deputy governor.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just thinking, way back when the whole idea was to put mechanisms in place to ensure that these processes work better. But what I'm seeing here from these, the procurement and this process selecting mm-hmm. The deputy governor, you know, they are frustrations. And I'm wondering why we're, you know, arriving at these stalemates and we are saying that we are moving on to better things. You know, can you just explain why we are at these
You mean in
position?
General? In general?
Generally, case, yes.
Well, and this isn't in reference to the DG.
No,
the
generally,
the DG.
Because we've been having these issues.
Yeah, okay. So let me just talk about recruitment, because I think that's what you're talking about on the HR side. There are lots of checks and balances in the recruitment process, and some of them... And I've had this discussion with people all through the system, including the Public Service Commission, that probably aren't necessary, you know? There's a lot of back and forthing that goes on, you know, of selection of this, and then it goes to this committee, and then it goes back, and then it goes through HR, and so on and so forth, that are procedures that we practiced a long time. Some of them are in the general orders, you know, and so on, that do take a lot of time because, you know, people are not there and maybe the information doesn't come as fully and so on. So one of the things that this review will be looking at very closely is the whole thing about recruitment. We've already started that. You'll remember me talking about this sort of 90-day thing where we have actually managed in some key appointments to bring it way, way down from what it was before. And one of them, I believe it was the CMO appointment, was done in 74 days, which is really, really good, considering it was done with this system. But we will change it in consultation with all of the parties so that it is more efficient and more effective. And that there is, and I think I've said this publicly before, and that's something to consider, is that not every appointment needs to go to the Public Service Commission. Right now they do, because unless the Public Service Commission under the Act delegates that responsibility somewhere else, you know, they do have that responsibility. So some of them are really don't need to go that route. And we will be talking to the Public Service Commission about how to make that easier. So it'll lighten the load of the Public Service Commission, and it will be a lot less kind of circular stuff going on, fewer steps for some of this, which means the delegation of some HR responsibilities that's already happening in some departments has been there for some time, to departmental, delegating some of the HR functions departmentally. So that's one of the ways of doing that. There's a whole lot of other steps along the way, but we can change them, and we will change them. So we will make recruitment shorter. We're already doing that, but we'll make it more efficient as well.
Your Excellency, a lot of things stick. Mm. I remember you saying that the selection team for the deputy governor post, they did a great job.
They did.
And so I'm trying to figure out, if there was such a great job, why were we unable to have someone in place?
Well, you answer that question for me.
I
you
can't.
Know, that you can do a very, very thorough job. It's a very difficult decisions. The delay in getting someone in place is subsequent decisions and dealing with individuals and having to go through, in some cases, negotiation and so on. So that's also what takes a long time in the recruitment process. But sometimes, you know, a decision is made, a deliberation is made, you know, and you can't fault the board if they applied the standards that they were required to apply in terms of competencies and so on. So it was very rigorous in that sense. So you can't fault the board that they applied what they were supposed to apply to the process.
Okay, fine. We're not faulting the board. You mentioned a word just now, and you know it caused me to think, negotiation.
Mm-hmm.
So that this is outside of the process of the board.
Yes, this is once an offer has been made.
So what I'm getting is that it was at that stage that everything broke down.
Nothing has broken down.
There leads to my confusion again.
On that digi thing. So you said that, so there has been a selection and negotiation is ongoing?
No.
Is that what you're
suggesting? I said there has not been a selection for a deputy governor.
Right.
However, I have decided to appoint an acting deputy governor.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm in the process of appointing an acting deputy governor.
So you see what? Well, then I don't understand. James asked. I don't know, why did we talk about negotiation? Where did that come in?
There's always a negotiation when you appoint someone to a position when they
start. Oh, so we are in negotiating with an acting deputy governor.
That's correct.
Oh, that's weird.
Yeah.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
I thought that was. I think when James asked about the breakdown,
yeah,
that was part of the problem in selecting in the first instance. That matter is out the door.
No.
That matter is out the door.
Yeah.
So we are now talking about negotiating. Because my next question was going to be, prior to now, was who is this person? Has the selection been made?
So as I said, as soon as this part is finished, I will make an announcement to that regard. So let me just point out too, because there will be people who are going to the Constitution and looking at, ooh, what does it say about a deputy governor? What does it say about an acting deputy governor? I have consulted very, very deeply with attorneys both here and in the UK, and that is why we've separated those two positions, right? So deputy governor is a particular thing under the Constitution. Acting deputy governor is a particular thing under the Constitution. So we have to work around that in order to achieve the practical goal of having somebody in place, even though we weren't able to select a deputy governor from the recruitment that we did, who can act as deputy governor, as an acting deputy governor, for a length of time that will allow some stability to the position so that we can then move to appoint a substantive deputy governor for a longer term.
And the acting deputy governor is one that you can appoint without applications being made or anything like that?
No, I don't want to go into any details about that, but I can assure you that an assessment was done. And when I announce the person, I will talk about that. Because I don't think it's fair to be talking about, you know, those kinds of things until a person is in the position and while negotiations are still going on.
Your Excellency, this deputy governor position, I remember sitting in this very room way back when the first deputy governor was appointed,
yeah,
questioned it, and it was our first lady Excellency, mm-hmm, who said, let's give it a try.
Yes.
And it seems, yeah, as if we're having a lot of problems, yeah, ever since. So, I mean,
well,
this is not new. This
no,
this
and what we
problem
have to do, what we have to do in these situations is innovate, you know? And that's
very well.
And in fact, what I'm trying to do here, which is it establish some continuity in the tasks of the deputy governor through a method that hasn't been done before.
Well, very well done. Innovate. Mm-hmm. Great.
At least, Your Excellency, you are actually trying some things.
Yes.
You know, and let's hope that they work.
Yes, and for me, it's more than hope. I'm going to make sure they do.
I live by hope.
Yeah.
There's a situation, Your Excellency. I believe that you've heard of it or you know of it. Concerning workers at the airport. There's a situation. I think I'm not understanding it fully, but it has to do with some workers who have had previous convictions.
Yes.
And they are not allowed security passes, yes, to enter, yes, certain places. So what is the situation and how are we dealing with it?
I have to say, I think it was dealt with really, really well. The regulations do not permit that. So action was taken both by the management of the airport as well as the places, the parts of government where those positions were held, to ensure that those people were placed in other employment where that stipulation is not in force. So it was held. It was done, I think, quickly. It was done very, very humanely and with a lot of consideration. And from what I've been told, everything has been dealt with and taken care of to the satisfaction of both the operation as well as the individuals.
So those workers, they're still in the employ of the government?
As far
but they're
as
being
I know,
relocated?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that's my understanding.
All right, because it was not clear.
No, and it's not the sort of thing that people would necessarily talk about a lot in public, unless it was the individuals themselves, because some people want these matters to be private, you know.
Yeah. Still on the airport now. There has been an incident at the airport, and the thing about the incident and what concerns me is that any incident or anything at the airport or the incidents impact very heavily on our whole access situation. And it's with that mm-hmm, concern that I'm going to ask this question. There was an incident on the on Saturday, September 3, at the airport. First of all, was anything filed? Was any report filed? And was there any investigation? And is that what should normally happen?
I think I know what incident you're referring to. And I have just recently heard about it. I've heard one version of what happened. And I have now sought a full report and information from the two. Remember, the Border Services is a combined with the Customs and the police, so I've sought a full report. So at this point, yes, when things like that happen and I hear about them, I do request an investigation and a report.
I'm surprised that you talk about hearing about it.
Yes.
What I'm trying to find out really, isn't that a normal thing that whenever there is anything that immediately
something
is filed?
I would have thought that this would have been reported to me, but it wasn't officially reported to me.
I hope so. Anyway.
Yeah.
We will see. Well, I'm glad to hear this. So we will get a report on that.
I will definitely request a full report.
Yes, thank you very much.
Moving on. Yes. Martin, yes. Seem to be the forgotten link.
I was wondering, sorry
about that, Martin. It wasn't intentional, but there were some key issues.
But let's
just look at an update, because we've heard that there's been some movement. You mentioned initially that the undersea fiber, the tender for that was being prepared.
Yes.
So can you just give us an update on where we are with that?
Yes, I can indeed. Obviously, I can't say go into too much detail because it's commercial in confidence, but I would say just towards the end of August, we launched the pre-qualification questionnaires to the market. I think it'd be fair to say the response we had to that was mixed. I think we were surprised. I think we expected a little bit more greater response, but we did get a response to it, and we've assessed those pre-qualification questionnaires, and we're quite happy. So we're now moving to the next stage, which is the invitation to tender process. So we're going to be, I think, a pre-bid meeting with some of those potential tenderers, just to make sure they're absolutely clear of what we're asking them to provide, and then we'll launch the ITTs, as it's called, in the next few weeks.
So any idea? When? A likely time frame?
The launch of those ITTs? Yes. I would hope that will happen within the next 2 months, if not earlier. So that's just because there's a number of other procurement activities that are going on that we need to be focusing on at the moment. So
and just going to those?
Well, obviously, the ferry process that the Premier announced earlier in this week, that's obviously something that DFID is now running with. So that's going to take up some procurement time as well.
That ferry process, there was an accusation in the Premier's announcement that seems to involve you. Are you aware of that?
I did hear something where my name was mentioned. Yes.
Well, I don't know if it's your name, but your position, your title. And kind of surprised to hear that. Is there, but let me go back a bit. I wasn't expecting to see you, according to some reports that I got, except that the governor, I'm still waiting a response on certain matters from that, moved to
clarify,
make some correction.
In consultation with DFID officials, by the way, in London, about what we should
when I heard very recently that, in fact, he's not coming back, and that he's been thrown and strangely enough, from sources that you think would know and should know that this was so. But what concerned me about that was your reaction to the comments that were associated with your being sacked.
My personal reaction to that?
Yes. What's your reaction to those?
I did
tell you. I will ask you.
I must admit, initially, my initial reaction was one of amusement, and also that I should feature so highly in the press and on the island, going back to meetings in East Kilbride, which is something we do annually. So I'm quite prepared to share with you my travel plans and leave plans over the next 3 months, so you know exactly where I'll be. Yes, I think it's just a reaction, but I just thought, well, this is obviously some some jiggery pokery that's going around and just to ignore it, so that's fine.
Very good. So, and then the question I had asked, because when I did hear about the about it first time, is to ask, what's your length of contract? What's your contract with us? In Montserrat. What's your time on that?
I'm quite happy to share with you, because I know there was some discussion about this while I was away. I'm at the moment, Mr. Roach, I'm contracted to be here to September 2017. So that's a whole year.
And that was your initial?
My initial contract was till 2016.
It was a three-year contract.
It was a two-year contract initially. And I was asked at the end of 2014 or 2015, would I like to stay for a third year? And I indicated that I would. So that takes me up to September 2017. That whether I extend beyond that is up for discussions with the departments and obviously with the government here.
Sure. I ask that because my initial feeling was before I saw what all took place. In fact, I only saw it after I got the official negating the story. I said, but coming to think of it, you might have reached the end of your contract.
If that had happened, there would have been an announcement well ahead of it. Yeah.
Really now?
Yes.
Yes.
The same way as any of us, when we come to the end of our terms, it's known for some time beforehand.
Yes, indeed.
A successor, yeah. Yes, as well.
With the announcement of a successor. Yeah.
Well, so you're with us until September next year. Barring some of these things that they're saying that we get you, we pack you off out of here. Which yes. brings me to, there was no announcement about our procurement person who was ceremoniously, I was going to say, rather than using the unceremonious, but ceremoniously sent away from here. And what comes to me is, all the questions that we have asked long before you about this procurement issue. What was the function of this person with regards to procurement?
Well, he was the director of procurement and commercial services, so he was the head of the unit.
He was the head of the unit. Mm-hmm. But we've had people who have come to assess, make changes or recommendations to changes and so on, because there was this dissatisfaction or unease with the procurement act as it was. Was that part of his function? Was he supposed to be making those recommendations, making those changes, training people and so on?
That was part of the function, but I think we'll realize, along with the government of Montserrat, that the challenge for procurement is even bigger than we originally anticipated. So I think that's, you know, it's quite clear that with the procurement, I think there needs to be more resources brought in to assist in doing the things you've said, legislation, but also the training of people and the regulations.
So where did he run in? How did he run into the problem he ran into, whatever that was? Because I still don't know what it was.
I think it's just the scale of the activity, and obviously, so I think you probably need to put these questions to the government of Montserrat.
Yeah, you should. You should be asking the government of Montserrat because he reported into the financial secretary.
Martin. I understand you're saying that we could ask the government of Montserrat. What I'm trying to figure out, though, when you get these people to come into certain positions, hasn't an assessment been done so that you will know the needs that are required? So hearing you saying now that possibly, you know, it was bigger than was first anticipated, or for him, I'm taken aback, because normally I would you know, see you doing an assessment of the situation to get a thorough understanding of what the situation is on the ground, and then you bring in the resources to help. So why are we at this stage?
Well, I think we did do the assessment along with the government of Montserrat, but I think once you then start to unpack and get involved in the process, you realize it's probably more complicated, and I think that's probably the situation we find ourselves now. So the action is to do more and to strengthen the unit even more than we originally anticipated.
So any idea of how long this will take?
Well, I know it's a priority for the new financial secretary to replace the previous incumbent, and also we were discussing yesterday about additional posts within the unit that could be funded by the TC element of the financial aid.
So negotiations are going on?
Yeah.
Okay.